It is Sunday morning in Luero district, in a village called Zirowe, on a hot September day. We come to this village health center to find an early morning gathering. Zirowe Health Center 3 draws from a large inflow of village residents who line up for medical care sometimes for as long as a whole day. The queues may reveal the needed health services, but this can also suggest the increasing cases of HIV/AIDS infection that is reportedly on the rise. Today's visit is organized by Uganda Network of AIDS Services Organization, UNASO, and involves four teams sent on four routes around the country. The task is developing a national accountability scorecard on the HIV/AIDS response, which is advocated in the five-year HIV/AIDS National Strategic Plan. Prior to the beginning of the health scorecard, an assessment of governance and accountability mechanisms was conducted in 2012 to determine the state of the response to the HIV/AIDS problem. It provided inadequate results, and there arose a need to have a more informative result. The use of a community scorecard was selected as the appropriate method.
As a country, we have the mechanisms for governance and accountability. We have annual partnership forum. We have joint annual reviews. We have the coordination mechanisms. We have partnership committee meetings, which take place every quarter and have been taking place every month. Now it's quarterly. We have arrangements and the annual AGMs for non-government actors. However, we needed also to understand further how the actual leadership, governance, and accountability would have an implication for what the service delivery.
The actual groundwork began with the formation of a technical working group in mid-2013. General preparations were done to establish the work basis in 14 districts. More so, the working group was asked to provide oversight to the UNASO team in planning the process and in developing the required tools.
When you look at the accountability framework and the governance, it has many different areas. For example, it has citizen participation, the response. How are the citizens participating? The transparency and accountability, how transparent? Sharing information, is the information available shared with all stakeholders and beneficiaries? Are the resources being utilized or brought in and invested in the HIV service delivery shared commonly? People know, understand why these things are there. Are there consultations around some of these interventions which practitioners we put in place and propose to be implemented? So there, that is the whole question of what of governance and accountability. Now, how engaged are the leadership? Does the leadership engage the beneficiaries?
The group also advised on the period of the scorecard and agreed on areas for the meetings within selected districts. This was followed by identifying facilitators who were trained by UNASO to equip them with the working knowledge of the scorecard. And UNASO made contact with the leaders in the selected areas to dialogue, inform, and explain to them the program and its purpose. Other partners and service providers were informed too. Facilities to assess in the districts were selected, and the health inputs to be tracked were identified. What followed was mobilization of the community, who were notified about the forthcoming scorecard process. In the health scorecard process, participation is defined at three levels: the health recipients, the service providers, and the community leadership, also called duty bearers. Mobilizing the community is very crucial because it lessens the time of activity in the field, and people turn up in a more receptive way because they have been organized.
Some of those ones are even key informants. You are going to interview them. So there is that interaction which is purposely to introduce yourself that here you are, this is the methodology, and the purpose.
Okay. A week before embarking on fieldwork, the larger team involved in the scorecard process gathers at the headquarters of the Uganda Network of AIDS Service Organizations. As the network body coordinating, UNASO enjoys the benefit of expertise in such processes. The training session here is orientation about the field processes and the tasks to the participants.
Why do you have this? Is to help you be able to fill in everything these people say. An FGD, it brings out, you know, it's the qualitative data. It has to bring out someone's feelings. Someone can just ask me and then, what do you have to take seven?
What is expected to be captured in the field is laid out. The necessary tools to apply and how to do the data entry. How are respondents handled? How are team members supposed to communicate? And the appropriate language to use, because the people expected in the field activities are persons living with HIV/AIDS. And therefore, sensitive remarks must be checked to avoid offending anyone.
It's supposed to have a delivery room where women deliver from. And then it's supposed to have a store where they keep their linen. It's also supposed to have a male ward where those of malaria, blood fever, divisions.
This trainer is briefing participants about applying scores to identified questions. 2 days after orientation, the teams are dispatched from the headquarters. On average, each team has 7 people on each of the 4 routes, and the journey to the field begins. Once in these localities, the teams engage the participants from the community in developing the performance scores, and the method proceeds with scoring on each indicator on the basis of the set standards. UNASO at this point starts by bringing together the community and setting up gatherings like this one in Zirowe, a health center in Luwero. In the mornings, first is physically explaining the purpose and methodology of the health scorecard. Information on the rights to health of the service users is shared. The ensuing phase is employing the scorecard. The community members present embark on assigning the indicators. An essential element at this stage is input tracking that occurs early or concurrently with focus group discussions. It includes tracing inputs, including all resources allocated to the centers during delivery of health services. The level of input from duty bearers is examined by a team member and includes assessing the physical conditions of the facilities. These are the number of staff who should be employed at the center, numbers of equipment, types of services offered, and the numbers of houses for staff, among others. It is crucial because it informs the proceedings in scoring for the pointers, and what is tracked is what is indicated on the matrix sheet. The commended facilities at Health Center 3s, like this one in Luwero District, include a counseling room, dental clinic, dispensing room, outpatients department and store, examination room, office, laboratory, treatment room and operational theater. In the ensuing dialogue, focus groups sit and have been divided on gender basis, with women alone, the men alone, and then service providers alone. Each group is assigned a facilitator and a supporting team member, and the questions written on the matrix sheet are pointers on which the groups are asked to score. As the process demands, the facilitator leads the exercise and the other team member takes note of the discussions. After the facilitators have given the score to the first question, it is asked why the score is thought so, and this must be backed. When the score is low, suggestions are sought on how betterment can be attained. And for the ones with high marks, facilitators seek ideas on how to maintain or even endeavor for improvement. Questions are asked. Answers are given, assessments are done, obstacles are identified, and all the issues raised in the focus group discussions are noted. Later in the day, an interface meeting is convened during which both service users, providers, and the duty bearers present share the issues raised in the scoring processes. It is here that a consensus score is arrived at, making way for recommendations or improving services.
The community scorecard uses the scores to measure performance against the set standards by the national governments. And we talk to women alone and ask them what are their scores against those standards. Then later we talk to the men alone, still within the focus group discussion, the score the same. Then later we talk to the service providers. In this case, our service providers are our health workers. In the afternoon, we all sit together and share, and we get to know how are we scoring against the different groups of people we've talked to. And then later we get a consensus score as a community, and then we devise ways how do we rectify to move from 1 to 5, 1 being the least scored and 5 being the highly scored.
Other concurrent activities occur with a team member meeting duty bearers in their offices at the district headquarters. They include district leaders, HIV/AIDS focal persons, district health officers, and other related staff available. It is after the community group concludes the process that the vote of thanks is passed, commending the people for committing time, ideas, and participation. Leaders from each group that are active and can represent their group's views are asked to converge on an appointed day and date in a separate place to come up with consolidated scores that will represent their respective area. And gender balance is a critical issue to observe in these considerations.
That gives creates a platform for, first of all, the communities or the beneficiaries to know some of the services which they are entitled to in the community. They get to know some of the benefits of the services, and they also get to know some of the challenges, why services are not being delivered in that very community.
In the subsequent period, a scorecard with service providers will be initiated. It is usually conducted after the community scorecard has been completed and basically provides a platform for health service providers like it does for the end users. Its space for generating issues of concern, however, and the scoring on questions with service providers is less strenuous and weaker because of the literacy levels and knowledge of participants. In many instances, issues and scores assigned by the health providers are similar to those of the community because both will often identify the same issues, but from different angles. Health providers may only add a few issues not mentioned by the community.
When I'm doing my work in the office, when the health workers are at their facilities, when we know that there are some people to assess or to come and follow up on what we are doing, everybody, I think, will be effective in whatever he or she is doing, because this system of being scored afterwards is there.
The issue is all about sensitizing the communities on how to do it. Yeah, because, I mean, some people could come up with bias because they had, they disagree with one health worker, then they take it to be the entire facility. So, I mean, the people who are to participate should be guided in through what they are supposed to do.
This phase is also quicker because it doesn't require to consolidate scores, given that health providers come from one institutional group, unlike the communities that are sparsely located. And since it provides an open-minded and critical environment which favors everyone to take part in the process, one can depend on the outcome.
The government has a role to play. The community has a role to play. The civil society organizations have a role to play. The public sector also has a role to play. So to understand how we are performing is very crucial in that, because initially what we are doing, the past reviews, the government goes to the health facilities. They get these numbers, so many people are on treatment, so many people have been tested, so many people have been circumcised, but they never get to know how are we performing in the eyes of the beneficiaries.
The subsequent phase is the validation exercise that shapes the final health scorecard report. It is set by confirming the dates, venue and participation with the leaders of all participants. Community leaders like local councils, chiefs, individuals who were involved earlier, district HIV/AIDS focal persons, service providers, district officials and UNASO staff converge. Preferably, it will also attract political leaders, NGOs in the HIV/AIDS programs, community-based organizations, donors and health ministry officials.
In service delivery, you've got both the supply side and the demand side. The supply side is the services being provided by the implementers. But we also need to know how the demand side is behaving. How are the people perceiving the services being rendered to them? Do they think they are quality services? Do they meet their expectations? Or do they have ideas as to how those services could be made more friendly, more efficient, more acceptable? That is the whole idea of also talking to the recipients of the services. And their opinions matter. Today, we do take this as a serious aspect of service provision.
This phase creates engagement at national level and shapes the final health scorecard report. With the findings shared, explanations sought, reasons given, and adjustments mentioned, the phase will see new information emerge on situations earlier seen otherwise.
It helps to improve the services, to point out what is lacking, to point out what is not working, to point out where more effort is needed, and so I would feel that the scorecard helps to raise these issues.
Issues in order of priority are listed. An action plan is drawn with a minimum time frame set, for instance, between half a year and 1 year for follow-up.
I would urge really the duty bearers and service providers promote that opportunity to know that this is an opportunity for them to give information which the beneficiaries did not have, but also the beneficiaries also to give feedback to the health workers and duty bearers that this is what they think the services are.
The follow-ups are joint measures taken by all stakeholders to ensure implementation of plans, and they are collectively agreed as set outcomes.
The moment we have every stakeholder on board, the community, the service providers, the leaders, the politicians, the faith-based, I do believe that we can be able to harmoniously be able to solve some of these challenges. The only way we can tell them that examine us, tell us where we are doing well, where we are not doing well, we need to first empower them with a level of information that this is what we have brought for you as a service, and this is what you expect from us, and this is what we expect from you as beneficiaries.
After weeks of activities that include traversing villages and engaging a number of groups at different levels, the teams are back at headquarters and the last phases are in progress. Officials embark on compiling the final report with the joint action plan that will include follow-ups. The last exercise that picks the health scorecard is the report launch. It is during this occasion that the findings are laid out to the different stakeholders and taken to districts. Follow-ups on the recommended actions are consequently started, and attempts are made to foster improvements on the identified gaps.
We want to move away from just doing a once-in-a-year snapshot. We want to do it continuously. We want to be able to monitor our progress. We want to be able to monitor our accountability processes. We want to be able to monitor our transparency process on a regular basis, on a monthly basis, on a quarterly basis, on an annual basis.
It is vital to always have the scorecard held continuously. When the practice is institutionalized on a sustained basis, the feedback information is critical in the service providers and decision-making systems. As a tool, it generates issues that can be supported and integrated into policies and systems as solutions for sustained outcomes.
Nsanyukidde nnyo ku bitongole ebimu ebigambye nti obuyambika bujje so direct ku akawunti za local government. Abo abeebala okuba abayivu bavee Kampala bajje basupervising ebintu bino nga bwe bikolebwa wansi kubanga emirimu giri wano. Amalimiro tegali ku mu parliament, tegali ku region, tegali ludo, gali eno ku byalo. Bwe bagamba nti local government zina capacity, gye yaba balina capacity babeere wano. Teri yasoma n'agamba nti nzisomye kubeera wano. Yasoma kubeera muweereza w'abantu. Genda eri abantu gye bagira ki? Gye bali.
The purpose of the outcomes and action plan will be to inform and impact on existing plans in health responses and the delivery of services. But planning will afterward take into consideration the needs of the people. All stakeholders in the process from the start have to own it and are best placed to take part in implementing the plan. A scorecard is consistently repeated to provide an opportunity for assessing if there has been any improvement from applying the joint action plan. The repeat involves the same process with the same communities and the service providers as participants to check if the joint action plan has been effected and whether there are improvements in health service delivery. Repeatedly, scorecard processes are best held in timeframes of 6 months to 12 months, and a scorecard like this one is an opportunity providing a platform for communication to every participant in health service. It is not meant to be a forum for confrontation. It therefore is not about people or individuals, but systems, structures, policies and processes.
Organizations begin to show some level of accountability. Organizations begin to have the strength to present themselves before government and say, here is our accountability. Where is your accountability of the taxes that we give you? And I think that a scorecard is able to deliver on that level of impact, of outcomes, that we are able to show that as civil society organizations, we are accountable, we are transparent to the people that we serve, to the AIDS development partners, to the government of Uganda.
And importantly, it underscores immediate response and joint decision making with well-generated and shared plans for improvements.
When you go down to the grassroots there, you will find a different opinion. From there, you can build it in the process. Because now, like if you compare what you have got from the ground there, what you have got from technical people, and what you have got from medical staff and politician, you can now, from there you can build what the real picture of the effect of HIV or what, or the contribution of the community towards this.
These are arrived at through mutual dialogue between all stakeholders that take part. This makes it acceptable, easily owned, and features shared efforts on everyone's part to implement it.
We are not going to all of a sudden have the 2,000 civil society organizations under the network of aid service organizations running at the same time. Some are going to run, others are going to walk, others are going to first think through it. But I believe that 4 or 5 years down the road, we believe that many of the organizations will pick it up as a good practice.
You don't have to take them from the macro level. At the micro level, some actions were agreed on during the process. And we hope some of those actions that may not require bigger resources and what are going to be what to be taken.
When we have that information, we take it on board and use it as an advocacy tool to talk to government in the context of increase of allocation of resources to the health sector.